Talking about the campus, talking about institutions, I think a lot of things have been said. But what I thought was, today I would just try to tell you how this happened. Perhaps that is the story which might be most interesting. It was in 62 that I was talking about School of Architecture, and I was teaching at Penn, and Dr. Sarabhai asked me that we would like to do the IIM Ahmedabad. So who is the person that we should have along with you? And I thought nobody else but Louis Kahn. And that is how the IIM Ahmedabad began. But more than that, a teacher, a philosopher, and he started talking about learning, the process of learning. Learning under the tree, learning by the gurus. So he almost talked as if, you know, that he belonged to the Indian ashram. And that is how IIM Ahmedabad started. And I had visited the Harvard University to look at their campus. What was interesting about education was that how does one make people free and not confined? And then over almost 20 years, we continued on the campus, and the campus was built. That was the time NID also was built. And during one of our meetings, I met Professor Ramaswamy there. And he suggested that we have to build the IIM campus. So why don't you come here and work with us? So we had two offices together, and he convinced the government that we would do this and he would build this IIM campus. And he was concerned about two things. One was the bullock cart, the farmers, and the other one, the management. The Western model, but present model, and small-scale industries. And he said, could we do this campus? And this is how we got involved with the campus. And we continued this over time. But what was important was, what is the nature of the campus and how does education happen? And as I mentioned earlier, in the Gurukul system, or let us say the Rabindranath Tagore's Vishwabharati, cultures don't happen only single-handedly. It is a participatory process. An educational process usually doesn't have any doors. It has no boundaries. Freedom, choice, interaction and contemplation. I think they become major ingredients, and hardly there is a distinction between the junior and the senior, or knowledgeable or the less knowledgeable. So when you look at these things, then the campus, what could be the nature? So when I came here, I went round the places and I also saw the gardens, the Lal Bagh, Kabban Park. And it was my first visit, that was around 1976. And I was surprised with not only the climate, but the nature of these parks and people going through them. Today, of course, it's very different from traffic. But otherwise, you walk through city and city is full of parks. Trees are around all over. You hardly saw those bungalows and houses. So you saw only the garden city. So then I realized what this place is about, with lakes, water bodies, and green trees. Obviously, the temperatures also helped. The climate helped. The occasional rains, surprising clouds. So the thing was, how does one look at this? And that was the time also I went to Madurai temple. And when I went to Madurai temple, I saw the courtyards, the corridors, the places around, and shrines in between, but beautiful light, and people walking, meandering, but gradually changing their nature. You saw the expression on those who I followed. And I realized that there is two things that happen. One, the climate is influencing. The people who are around influence us. But also the process of movement also helps us. And that is how we presented the campus. And realizing at IIM that campuses are not built in one day. They are built over almost decades. The second thing I realize, that uncertainty in Indian conditions at that time, and even perhaps now, of finances, of faculty, of programs, becomes another change. And the third is that when we begin now, the times change very fast. So programs, activities also change and modify. So with this kind of flexibilities, the question would be, what would be the nature of the campus? And this is really the main idea of the place. And today I'm glad that when I come here, I get lost myself. And I wonder, how come this campus, you know, is like this? And I want to again take this opportunity to thank the Institute for creating the equal important part of the campus, that is the greenery, the landscape, and its maintenance. You don't clap with one hand. And I think this is the story of this campus. So what I would do is quickly go around and tell you about the site and the buildings. He talked about the student and the teacher. He talked about the relationship of them, their own, within themselves as cluster, and their relationship with the faculty block. He also talked about the ancient ways of working and studying. But two, three things happened, because it was the first time that he arrived. Like Corbusier had arrived, they were concerned about climate, orientation, breeze, and of course what we talk today of sustainability. How does one really create the places cool, comfortable, ventilated, and how do we use the natural resource such as sunlight and water? So this is what the campus was begun, and then he created these dormitories there, and the classrooms, the library and the faculty. This was in 62 and this continued to grow. So when the IIM Bangalore had to be built, it was already 12 years past, and I was teaching at Penn and I was talking to him all the time. But also I was visiting, as I said, I visited Indian places and others. So I was wondering whether that should be the case or should be otherwise. So I began to think about relationships between the student and the colleagues. That is, when the student meets student, what happens? The second thing would be the student and the faculty. Third, between the faculty. So first principle of plan I thought was, should we really have an interactive plan, and could we really make a plan? Second issue was growth. So would we be able to grow the plan? So that is how, not like this, but I modified this, and we created separate units around the connecting corridor so that classrooms can grow. And incidentally, over almost 20, close to 20 years that I worked here, lot of these buildings came up over time, and every time buildings were shifted on plan and built separately because the programs changed, requirements changed, and conditions changed. So the building had to be built in phases. Building needs to modify, buildings have to be added on. So the issue was, how does one create this paradoxical situation of flexibility, growth, interaction, and a plan which has to be frozen? So the whole idea was to not freeze the plan, but to create these segments. So this was built, as I will show you later, the first time. Second time we started building this immediately, this, and only part of this corridor. Then eventually we added some buildings here, and then third time we have added, or some of them are still not done. And this building was not here, library was shifted from there, there, and the auditorium was there. So all these shifts happened there together. So what it means is that in the temples and other campuses which are built over years, they have two ways to work out this. You work out a network, and then you work out the way that connection can happen. So this is what we did. The second issue was, a normal classroom would be of this kind. the faculty and the students. But I saw in Harvard, the circular one, where all these chairs are swiveling, so they can have a dialogue and they can have a discussion. So this interaction, I thought, was should be there not only in the classroom, but in their entire behavior between the students when they walk, when they move, when they go somewhere else, or they are alone or together, and likewise to faculty. One way was to put all these classrooms in a row, but then this would not solve the problem. This is how it began. So if that is not the case, then the next is to really find out the cluster. So one could begin to make clusters of classrooms around this with a court in between. And then the issue was, how does one really combine this, that you have 80 classrooms for 80, then sub-classrooms for 60, some for 40, some for 20, and then they will have to be combined in different formulations. Now this meant, you know, you are arranging a fruit basket. How does one really create variety of fruit and put them in different combinations? And this is very much like the Indian food, that you go to see, you can combine different places, different situations. So this flexibility, I thought, was a virtue of our own need. As a result, one could really try to find out, can we combine them in this way, alternate ways, etc. So this is how that plan was emerged. The second question was, when I started this project, the committee members asked me, what is the nature of the campus? How would it look like or feel like? I said, it would be very much like the temples of the south. And what I meant was, when you go there, they will be dispersed with courtyards, spaces to sit down, different variety of choices for everybody. And then you can go to places that you want to go. The land, when the land was acquired, I came here. And I must say that that time, and I think for Dr. Vachani, I was going to say that the land at the, across the road, I also took into account, saying that campuses grow. So let us take the land across the road and buy, get more land around. So this is how it was thought of. Unfortunately, this didn't happen, but the plan began like this, that if there is a water body, then you come in, then you go there, and there is a cluster. And this cluster is connected by the spine, and you can make housing and classrooms as if you know that they are like the Indian bazaars, or they are like the Indian communities. That shifted to the slope. The land is highest here where the present campus is. And then it gradually slopes down there, create an open space, so the housing. But I found that this was really creating segregations, etc. So that also we did not do. Next. So then the third question that came up was my observations of Fatehpur Sikri and the temple complex. When they grow in a certain way, but they are interconnected. So interconnection and growth and certain nodal points become very, very important in the planning. The other thing I found was that when you walk long distances, you have time to reflect, you have time to ponder, and suddenly you also meet by interact, by choice or by whatever the reasons are, people that you want to meet but you had never met. So which meant that if you create a network like these, then the growth is possible, but then you can also meet people by chance somewhere here. Now if one combines the two, then you begin to get this plan where you get choices, growth, interconnectivity, and then diagonal movement across. So this is really how the plan got eventually involved. I am saying this particularly to the student community, to just tell them that how one approaches design. So this way, if one was doing this, then the next question is, if the students have to come, then they always have dining areas, and then they have these rooms here, and they get connected. So we connected this across like this, etc. So this is really the way plan was made. And today, if you see these connections, this is what the campus is. And it doesn't look like as empty, but all these corridors, all these spaces are occupied and you are as if, you know, you are in an open, porous place.
So campuses have to be porous,
flexible, and they must also work with the climate. And every time we are there, we must connect with nature. So nature and building, the enclosed space and the open space, must go hand in hand, like our day and night, a place of rest, place of contemplation, place of work, go together. So those things which we did here, which is, this is the Google map, and this is how you see here, this is the MDC. But look at the campus and look at the surrounding, which was all green before. So in order to really create this green campus, in order to really filter Bangalore, like the park that I have seen, we created this kind of a campus where you really go and the buildings become part and parcel of the whole. So this is really how that campus has been made to suit the climate and the place. And I think from that point of view, it was important. Also, as Dr. Vasani said, that we have used natural material. It was important because we thought that in order to also make it economical, less maintainable, cooler, comfortable, employing local crafts, you can use natural material. So stone and concrete of course was not the local material, but it was easy to do and build. We built the whole campus, and if you see, it is almost grey campus, one color. And that one color is there, but it is a durable place because you don't need to do anything to it. But if the garden and the trees were not there, the story would not be the same. And I think this is where the strength has been, that 50% of the spaces are all open and 50% is built. So one is constantly moving between the two. Now, what does that mean? I think that means that I believe that in an education institution, there are no time conditions of timings. It's a continuous 24-hour movement. One is reflecting, one is questioning, one is answering, and one is interacting. And I think if that has to happen, then it has to happen not by compulsion, but by choice. And the only choice is to look at nature and work with nature and be part of nature. And I think that we have forgotten today in an air-conditioned world, in a world of glass, in a world of complete isolation. The other reason is, in Bangalore, the climate changes. So what we had to do was to find ways and means of go under a dry area and yet be part of the green space. And that is how this campus has been. And then it was built in phases. So if you look at the campus, then all these buildings are made of stone, but they are of different sizes, and there are these courtyards. This is the administration block, this is the classroom cluster. But we went on adding because every time the programs began to add something new. But the uniqueness about this is the perhaps only campus anywhere, as far as I know. It is a covered passage surrounded by walls, but partly open and partly green. So one is continuously walking almost within the green areas. But the important thing is, the sun comes into play, wind comes into play, which normally buildings don't have. So in this campus, you can recognize that you are not in the same place twice, because the sun changes, the shadows change, and the trees change. So that way, all these things, there is a duality philosophically of constant and variable. So all these things have really become part and parcel of the campus. So there is one vocabulary, one system, but then the passages that go here become very important. So there is a cross-circulation, diagonal circulation, parallel circulation, additions to the corridor. These are all faculty here. So this campus then You can see how it moves. This is how your movements take place. They are all alternatives.
You can be isolated, you can be together.
And this is how the phasing happened.
So, ongoing conditions
helped in this campus to grow. And in order add to that, because of the level of the ground, there are sometimes two floors, sometimes three floors, but all of them of the same height. But the staircases play a big role,
and the steps and the platforms. You know, it is a tradition in India, a platform, a otla, the plinth. People always sit there. People always want to gossip. They want to chat. And I think that is also the nature, you know, of the student world. So the model was made, and the bigger model was made, and we were wondering all this. This was the first time that we did like this, where we could create shadows, we could create spaces and study them in detail, including the skylights. And then this appeared, and as you see here, even protection was done by overhangs. The glass is put there, then there is a, this, that is in recess. There is an outdoor classroom, indoor classroom, and then there are these corridors from which you meander. So, learning is everywhere in this case. It is not in one place. Basically, the campus is technologically is very simple. It's very much standardized. But you will see variations.
And to my surprise, over time, the campus walls also have become now green. So, it is the only campus which is really green campus. But look at the kind of shadows in this place here. So, what I feel that education should not be imposing, neither its buildings. If we have easy way of doing it, a modest way of doing it, things work better.
I have been teaching, you know, since almost 30, 40, 50 years, and I find that the best thing to do is to really give freedom and choice and then have interactive sessions so that there is a lot more exploration than what is written on a paper. Accidental, surprising, intuitive.
And I think this way, what you saw this afternoon, were these only glimpses, they don't justify what you saw. But what I am going to now talk about is not only the campus, but doing this campus, I learned many things. That if one really does as a professional academic work and does the campuses, you begin to learn more about what is an habitat, what is a place, which really makes you feel at home. And is it possible that we really create our world, which is what you call habitat, really not an identifiable place, but one which integrates and merges? So, if we do that, then I think probably we will come closer to our ancient campuses and ashrams. Now, I will not take much time, but I would like to talk about two other campuses which have won the prize. We have won, Rajiv has won many prizes. But one of the most important campuses which we built in India, which he designed, one is in Flame in Pune, but the other one is Nalanda. And I think the case of Nalanda, which you mentioned, I think is very important because the condition was of net zero. So I think I would like to ask now Rajiv,